Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm delighted to welcome you in this very, very special session. We started in BioVision to look at the domain of biorobotics a number of years ago, and I'm happy to announce on this occasion that as of now, we will have an annual event on biorobotics. The field is moving extremely quickly, and we had the occasion to welcome in an earlier event the world's first cyborg, as he identified himself, Kevin Warwick, who communicated with a chip in his arm, and both in his brain and with his wife, who also had a chip implant in her arm. Well, the news yesterday, for those who didn't have the chance to listen to it, is of an amazing next step, which was a totally paralyzed person due to a spinal injury, spinal cord injury, where with a brain implant, they were able, the chip implant in the brain, they were able to get his hand to move again. And the hand moves in relation to instructions directly from his brain passing through electrodes and a computerized system to a receiver around the hand bypassing the spinal cord. It's an amazing next step. So a lot of things are happening. Now to take us into this very exciting world, so just to let you all know, and Dr. Faham and Marwa will make sure that they will send you all invitations to our heretofore coming annual event in biorobotics. And so we shall start now on our session. I'm delighted that our first speaker is Ronald Arkin, but before I introduce him, I want to also explain the setting we will do. We have a number of distinguished speakers, each of whom will speak for 20 minutes, and then we will have a little bit of a discussion among the speakers, and hopefully we'll have a little bit of time at the end for a few questions from the floor. At the very least, I thought it would be very interesting to have the interplay among the panelists themselves. So our first speaker is Ronald Arkin, who is the Regents Professor in the College of Computing at the Georgia Institute of Technology, Director of the Mobile Robot Laboratory, and Associate Dean for Research and Space Planning of the College. Now, his research interests include behavior-based reactive control, action-oriented perception, deliberative reactive architectures, robot survivability, multi-agent systems, biorobotics, human-robot interaction, robot ethics, and learning in autonomous systems. So without further ado, join me in welcoming Professor Ron Arkin.
It's a pleasure to be back here.
يشرفني أن أعود إلى هنا مرة أخرى. كنت هنا منذ أربعة أعوام.
And interestingly, although I won't be talking about neural interfaces and the like, as this panel is referring to, I will be talking about healthcare applications. Also, interestingly and oddly, kind of grew out of some of that earlier work that we have. This is work in progress that we're doing. We're under an NSF, National Robotics Initiative grant. It's a five-year program, we're 2.5 years through it. And it is joint with Tufts University, who are doing a lot of the work with the Parkinson's patients themselves. So what are we trying to accomplish in this? Well, this is a little bit unusual, even for human-robot interaction studies. We're concerned here with human-human interaction and how a robot can affect, hopefully in a positive way, humans and humans interacting with each other, particularly in the healthcare setting and specifically in early stage Parkinson's. It is well known in that community that due to certain characteristics, which I'll talk about in a minute, a stigmatization occurs between the patient and the caregiver. The caregiver over time loses empathy and the patient starts to suffer from shame and embarrassment.
And as you might imagine, when that occurs, there is a downward spiral for healthcare. The quality of care deteriorates. And the impact of that is that people have to be institutionalized, leading to larger costs and other aspects as well, too. And you might say, okay, maybe that's true, but what's a robot got to do with it? And I'm going to try and tell you what a robot may have to do with it, which is our underlying research hypothesis. And I don't know what happened there. Let's try again. Well, let's try it this way. There we go. Parkinson's disease is characterized by what's referred to as facial masking. There is a loss of muscle control in the face, and many of you may have either been caregivers or known someone that suffered from Parkinson's disease, which is a global problem, especially as lives tend to get longer and longer, and part of the reason why it's a chronic problem in the US. And this musculature and this control of the face leads to what's called a loss of nonverbal communication. We communicate with each other not only with words, but with gestures, with facial expressions, with the tone of our voice. All those things become lost, particularly the facial expressions and what's called prosody, which is the tone of the voice, in Parkinson's patients. And this is part of what causes that stigmatization. It appears that the person doesn't really care, although they are fully aware and fully capable of caring.
Parkinson's causes debilitating shaking or loss of muscle control. Nessa Weinman is director of the Parkinson's Association in Los Angeles.
People are living very long lives with Parkinson's. You know, with Muhammad Ali, you see that his face is frozen. You know, perhaps Mr. Williams was afraid that that might happen. His facial expression is so much a part of who he is and what he does.
So this is the core root of some of the loss of communication between patient and caregiver, which again produces this well-documented, scientifically documented stigmatization. My colleague, Linda Tickle-Degnan, at Tufts has written extensively about this particular phenomena. And the real question, again, is what can we do about it? There are other effects, such as body posture and the like. And this is, we say early stage Parkinson's because often, but not always, in late stage Parkinson's, dementia may set in as well, too. So that complicates things in terms of the ability to communicate and the ability to perceive the situation around you. But in this particular case, the people are fully cognitively aware, yet they are not well understood, which is incredibly frustrating and incredibly embarrassing. And if just imagine if you lost your ability to do that today. You would feel embarrassed and ashamed in trying to talk to people for that very same reason. And this is what Parkinson's, and particularly in the early stages, is about. And this produces this stigmatization, which is a result of this inaccurate impression of the person's personhood, and also that that impression is not only inaccurate, but it is less socially desirable. You can't communicate well. You're out of touch. You just don't seem to be a part. And what's interesting about human beings is that if we even have a full cognitive awareness of this fact, and the caregivers do, they understand that, it doesn't matter. It hits people at a subconscious level, and that's what the problem is. So if you want it to be right, this model of care is a good one, where you have these cues that are naturally circulating between caregiver and client or patient as you choose to use it. And what we're trying to do here is that. We are adding, in the cases that we're looking at, a small humanoid literally into the picture there. And you're familiar, Ismail, with Now. I remember you had your picture with it as well, too. We use Now as one of the robot platforms for this as well, too, a small Aldebaran robotic system for some of the work that we're trying to do and to see if that would work. And you're probably scratching your heads, saying, well, okay, so how? How do we do that? And that's kind of what we're going to talk about. But the underlying hypothesis is that we can create a companion robot that can be present in this particular relationship that will be able to affect the dynamics between the two human beings. And we have to do that subtly. People aren't going to take orders from robots, right? I mean, maybe you would, I don't know. And actually, there's some studies that have been done that people sometimes believe robots more than human beings in emergency situations. We have a colleague of mine at Georgia Tech just finished such a study. But we want this mediator. And the whole goal, again, from the ethical perspective, is to maintain dignity in this relationship so people don't get angry, people don't become ashamed, people don't become embarrassed. We want to be able to do that. And as you may be aware, in medical visits, and these can be also at home with visiting nurses or with physicians, a third-party companion is often present. What do they call that in something in the US? They have a phrase for it, your advocate, I think a medical advocate as well. And there are advantages for it. Communication is often easier, and the patients seem more comfortable at some points. But if the companion talks too much, it's not necessarily good for that particular relationship. And sometimes the patient feels embarrassed in front of another fellow human being talking about their particular condition. They need not suffer such an embarrassment, perhaps, with a robotic companion. So we're looking at this social robot as a bystander. In our studies, we've used three different models. We may use four as well, too. This is referred to as the morphology, the shape and the characteristics of the robot. The first one's just a stuffed robot. That's our control. We basically just put it on the sofa there. It doesn't do anything. It's a look like a stuffed robot. We have the now, which we use in several different modes. I'll talk about that in a bit. One is just static and one is attending. I'll show a little video of that later. And we also have this Milo R25 Robokind robot, which actually is capable of facial expressions. So it can actually smile at you, or it can frown at you, or show different aspects of that. I'll show some pictures of that in a little bit. So how did we approach this? And I try and not get too technical in this, but at a high level. For those of you who are here, that's probably just you, 4 years ago, in my talk, you heard certain aspects of an ethical architecture that we were building. And we imported some of that for the control of robotic systems to relate to people in more ethical ways. One aspect that we're focusing here is on the so-called ethical adapter. And in doing that, we're representing a certain class of emotions called moral emotions. I'll talk a little bit more about that. But shame, embarrassment, and empathy fit within that category. I've done work in the past for Sony, for Aibo. For 10 years, I worked with them as a consultant, the robot dog, and their small humanoid as well, too. I have patents in robot emotions, so at least the patent office believes in robot emotions. They don't believe in perpetual motion, though. The robot emotions for Aibo, for Sony, and for Samsung as well, too, in complex affective phenomena. So we study how humans feel, and we make no claim that the robots feel that way, but we do argue that the robots can appear to possess these particular emotions. The other aspect of the thing that we do is the ethical governor. We use that a little bit more in the lethal systems, but we use it here as well too. When patients' behavior gets outside of acceptable limits, we use the robots to steer them back in more overtly into normal ways. And the other techniques include what I'll call a partial theory of mind model, which means that the robot has to have an understanding of how, or a representation of how the patient and the caregiver are feeling at any given point in time. And we use proxemics and kinesics. Proxemics is the maintenance of spatial separation between people. And if I'm up here, you're probably fairly comfortable with that. If I come down right now and sit next to you, you might feel a little uncomfortable with that at this particular point, particularly if you don't know me. And kinesics is body language. That's the different kinds of forms, which can be simple things like this. It can be looking depressed. It can be your facial expressions and the like as well, too. We try and use all of those. So there are really two questions. We don't want to get the robot in the way. When everything is going fine, let it go. Don't intervene. Don't affect that. But the very first aspect we're trying to do is much more subtle. You know, if we make a robot intrusive, the physician or the nurse is going to throw that robot out the window. It's as simple as that. The real question is, how can we do this in a subtle way which will affect the relationship? And through these nonverbal cues, as I mentioned, the kinesics, imagine a dog sitting on a couch or something that perks up its ears or looks at you and makes you do self-reflection or makes you self-conscious about your own particular behavior. That's the sort of thing we're trying to do in this first aspect. There are many different types of moral emotions. As I mentioned, we're focusing on shame, embarrassment. Oops, I better stop walking in front of that, huh? Shame, embarrassment, empathy, compassion in this particular case. We use guilt in the past. We are using this for the military systems. We are using the same particular model, cognitive model, for that. And part of it is maintaining this relationship between the two human beings with respect to upholding dignity between them. And one of the ways is making sure that we eliminate as much as possible shame and foster as much as possible empathy. This notion of empathy can fundamentally change the relationship. And it should be present in patient caregivers. That's why you have patients and caregivers. That's why they're called caregivers. But caregivers can get to wit's end sometime, especially if the people don't appear to be appreciating or be caring about what you're doing for them. And unfortunately, the condition of Parkinson's causes that to appear. So well, there we've used a model from Smits and DeBoeck, this particular model, which was used for guilt. And basically what it consists of is a collection of components that are associated with guilt, a weighted summation of those particular components. We simplified it in our particular work, and we're still using this particular case as well, too. And breaking down, according to the existing scientific literature, those components in terms of shame, the way people feel shame, and the way people feel empathy, and using those in that particular equation to try and come up with an evaluation of how that individual is feeling. Because the robot has to have an understanding of the relationship, the dynamics. In other words, if there is a threshold, a lower bound, for example, where empathy is crossed, you have to make sure if that occurs, something must be done. Same thing for shame. If a certain level of shame or embarrassment is increased, if it gets above that particular point, you have to do something. So the real key is when we're using this kinesics and proxemics, we're treating it like a homeostatic process. We're trying to maintain it in as unobtrusive a way as possible. But if there are severe thresholds which are crossed, then the robot will actually create an overt response using the ethical governor. The way we do this is to look at both what is being spoken. My colleagues at Tufts are using what's called content analysis. So what the content of the language is that's going on reflects what's going on and how they're feeling. There's a story from Linda who talked about a patient who was, because Parkinson's patients are often diagnosed as being depressed, and he kept telling the physician, "I'm not depressed." But the physician didn't believe them, and he walked out with a prescription for antidepressants at the end of the session. You have to pay attention, and this perception that we have overrides sometimes what the accurate evaluation of the situation is. These other things as well too, including physiological signals. We'll be using heartbeat and blood pressure and other aspects as well too in our initial work to be able to get a better understanding of are people starting to feel embarrassed or ashamed, or is their empathy or rising at the expense of anger. And then we can use this as well too, use these particular techniques to not only talk about what's present, but to talk about the magnitude, how much of it is present as well, too. These are encoded and represented within the robot, and they are used as variables within the robot to be able to determine what action should be taken. And that basically leads from this framework. If you look at the bottom, we have the perceptual data going in, the measures of empathy and shame in our initial work, and using that to lead to an appropriate action for the robot to undertake. This is a formulation of work that we've been doing for decades in terms of behavior-based robotics, but it provides the cues, the natural cues, that hopefully, again, this is a research hypothesis, will assist in the treatment of early-stage Parkinson's as well. So after we do that, what kinds of actions do we do? Well, we have a variety of different cases. You can see Zeno's not too happy in the lower left-hand corner there, and now is showing can't do anything with its face, although the color of its eyes can work, but it can use body language in a broader sense, and spatial separation can also play a role. This is actually work that I did with Sony, showing the homeostatic balancing between these internal variables and action selection. How we feel inside affects what we do. It's not just our perceptual stimuli. That's more for animals and the like, although motivations such as hunger and fear and the like play a role in the releasing mechanisms for them as well. But we have this here as well. And I better take a look at the clock occasionally. Okay. Boy, running out of time. Okay, so we had the now example and various kinesics, but this shows some of the early work that we did. This was for Sony as well, too, on their Curio robot. This is without nonverbal behavior. The robot is just executing a greeting behavior. But we move that on, and we see an old friend. The spatial separation changes at this particular point. It's a little more welcoming. It bows a little deeper. We use a technology, an approach called behavioral overlays, so we didn't affect the other behaviors. But if you speak too loud, the robot starts to move away in this particular case. Is a little more sensitive to context in this particular context. Context in this context, that's a little redundant. Okay, and then if Curio's not happy with you for whatever particular reason, it may take a little more aggressive stance and change its behavior accordingly, still while greeting. And in Japan, where this was filmed and the work was done, even if you're angry at someone, you still have to bow to them. It is a requirement. But you don't have to pay attention in these particular cases. And you can signal your discontent in a variety of different ways. So this was sort of the early motivation that we had for this. And basically, when Azaz gets a little too close, this is the best we could do to indicate, you know, stay back a little bit at that particular point. So our first study dealt with these three robots. We have the Xeno under evaluation right now. We completed the human subject stuff, but I don't have any results as of yet. We had the stuffed robot, the static robot, the attending robot. We brought in human subjects, and we tried to stress them. We tried to create some stress. And this shows a few of the examples here. Oops, I guess it doesn't show any. Okay, so let's go back.
Can you tell me about a time in your life?
Let's try that. Okay, and you can see these are two of my my graduate research assistants here reenacting this. These are not the actual subjects. But the interviewer was trying to actually deal with disclosure, make people tell them embarrassing things, and then not pay any attention to them, which would irritate them. And we were trying to understand whether the morphology of the robot had anything important to do with this. And Xeno used facial expressions as well for this. We used a bunch of different measures, which are not really important here. The net effect were that in certain circumstances, the attending now, the one that was actually turning its head back and forth between the speakers, was perceived by them as listening to them. And there were no significant differences with respect to disclosure. It didn't make a difference. People were not discomforted, if you will, by the presence of the robot. The intervening ethical governor is the one, as I mentioned, which when you cross a particular boundary, it will step in. This is based on our work with the military initially. We've extended it now from rules instead of constraints. The rules are applied and evaluated. I'll talk about those briefly in a minute. Because I don't have much more than that. But you can see the different rules which we created for this. One was no yelling, no cursing, no interrupting or limited interrupting. You can't just be quiet all the time. You must stay in the therapy session and you must not do anything that's particularly dangerous. These are all derived from clinical manuals for occupational therapists as the ways in which they should conduct these particular strategies. And so these rules, let me see if I can show one or two. I have a couple of minutes left.
Okay, so we're going to be sorting some medication. Why don't you read the directions for this pill out loud?
Okay, it says to take two on an empty stomach once a day.
Good, so use the medication organizer and prescription directions to sort these pills. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Can't open the box.
Okay, but can you try one more time?
No, I already said I can't open it, okay?
I understand. Let's calm down a little bit.
Yeah, so the robot kicks in these points rather than having the human being do that. Other examples?
Okay, so we're gonna be nice work.
Well, when you're quieter, withdrawn, basically, if you don't do anything for a while, the robot will intervene. That'll take a little bit longer. Right. We measure the sound measures. Okay, if you try and leave the room, we use facial recognition in the robot. And so if a person is gone for a significant period of time, and there are issues as well, too, which we learned from our occupational therapist regarding safety and other aspects as well. But I am down to over 6 seconds right now, so I will move to the conclusion slide. This is work in progress. That's the bottom line. So this is better listed as a summary as opposed to conclusions. We want these robots to potentially aid initially in early stage Parkinson's. But you can imagine so much more, right? You can imagine in marriage counseling. You can imagine in parent-child relationships. Those are harder, though, because I don't have a clinical manual to be able to guide what the correct response is in those particular cases. But we want to encourage maintenance of dignity between human beings. Maybe we should use it for politicians as well, too. That might be helpful. That would be really hard, though, I'm not sure, especially in the US for the election season. I don't know if we could ever get anything done with that. But we want to make sure that we can find ways to understand empathy and shame, to model those sorts of things, and prevent loss of dignity on either side. You know, if someone, the caregiver, someone walks out on the caregiver, that's an insult to that particular individual. And we are continuing our human robot interaction studies. There are several papers on our website describing this project. And later at the round table, I guess we'll be able to answer any questions that you might have. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Ron, for this fascinating presentation and for this very exciting work that you do. And I still remember the excitement that I felt about the work that you were doing on the lethal governor in the military case from previous presentations. And that further reinforces my decision to ensure that this becomes an annual event, because there's so much being done all the time. Now, our next speaker is Mr. Abdulrahman Khidr, and who's going to put a laptop here. Yes, he can put it for you. Yes, thank you. I can continue speaking from here while the laptop is being put up for the presentation. And he is a fascinating person. He received his BS in computer science degree from the Institut National d'Informatique of Algiers, and the master's and PhD in robotics from the University of Pierre-Marie Curie. Presently, Directeur de Recherche at CNRS, and as well the Director of the CNRS AIST Joint Robotic Laboratory, which is in Tsukuba, Japan. He's also leading the Interactive Digital Humans team. That's an interesting observation. Are these little guys inside your computer? Or are they little guys who follow you around? Or So he's leading anyway. He will tell us, I'm sure, all about that. The Interactive Digital Humans team at the CNRS University of Montpellier in France. And his research interests include the haptics with the touch, and the humanoids, and recently, thought-based control using brain-machine interfaces. So please join me in welcoming Professor Abdulrahman Khidr.
So thank you very much for the presentation, for the invitation. It's the first time I come to Egypt and to Alexandria, so I'm very happy and delighted to be among you and to share some of the thoughts I have. So I didn't know really what was the major conference, but I expected that the audience has a different background of science and that I would be speaking to a large audience. So then I made a talk which is more presenting some controversy things, particularly my point of view on some issues, and try to be pick up some things I think it's important to share with you. But of course I will not be as much focus on a particular point, but if you'd like to learn more about something I have been talking about, just ask me later on. So I titled my talk on human-centered robotic augmentation because it's what it came after several path of evolution that robotics has undertaken recently. So this is the where the labs are located in Tsukuba. It's about 60 kilometers in north of Tokyo. Where it is a joint lab between the CNRS and IST, and that we established on 1994. And then it became an international mixed unit, the same kind of full-fledged laboratory you find in France, but the exception is that it's located in Japan in 2008. And then, since then, I am leading this lab. And they have in Montpellier, which is in the south of France, a Mediterranean coast city, another team which is called Interactive Digital Humans. So digital humans is, of course, the simulation of a human, but it's also its representative avatar through beaming a human with robot. Okay, so what I will be talking about is more concerned with the quest for human augmentation or substitution. That's the big question. Of course, we like to say that it's more an augmentation than a substitution, which is the truth in general. But many of my colleagues would argue also on that it's a substitution, and not necessarily an augmentation. So that's an open debate for the societies, and we need to talk about it anyway. Of course, there are several types of augmentation. There is this enhancing the intellectual capabilities. It means it's not just a matter of robotics, mathematics, computers towards wearable and software, chemical. All of these things are humans has quested research on how what are the means he can put in practice or he can invent to augment his intellectual properties. And of course, so inventions, product that could also augment or enhance your perceptual capabilities, like night vision systems and access to third-party thought, for instance, would be interesting for the police and for the defense departments. And of course, enhancing physical capabilities has been a long quest through all the history of humanity. Different tools, machine, vehicles, chemicals, also, and robotics and AI. So the artificial intelligence. I will see a few seconds what I think about this. Is probably gathers almost all of the three in one system. So. So to understand this, we might probably make a very short journey into the evolution of robotics through the history and see, because it teach us what would be the perspective in the future. And if you compare it with the computers, that you see that there are a lot of similarities and commonalities in the way that things are evolving. The robots are the beginning, a matter of what you see from this animate robot in 1950, was just a big machine which picked objects from A to B location, as was a first computer who was doing just additions, subtractions of numbers. Then through the evolution, this computer became a matter of big computing centers so that you can do computations of more sophisticated things. And the robot has evolved to industrial productive robot that you can put in the production lines. And then they became robots who can do more sophisticated tasks in the industry, as it is shown in this picture. And then the true revolution came when the computers quit the computing centers to become a personal computer and that you can own in your pocket today. And I think it's something which is happening with robotics through several perspectives. It started by teleoperation and then going from teleoperation to services. And then from services, the robot will get closer to the human. And I will show you later that by getting closer to the human, the design and everything was already started to shape into a different perspective. And then we have now robots which are integrating again the industrial things, but they're changing the way the production is made. And then this is the image that you can see on the right, but you cannot really distinguish what is inside, and I will come to it later on. So this is before and now. So this is the image you need to get in your mind now, and then I will come to the other one later on. As you can see here, you have the product, and then you have this production line where you have this robot programmed or pre-programmed to do the things in a very well-structured environment. And basically, the production line, everything has been done so that the robot is included. And as you can see in the image, there is no person, no human in the production line, or they are hidden far from the robots. Then started the quest of this intellectual augmentation and artificial intelligence, which finds at the starting robotics has a very good or I'll say fashionable tool to try things, and it doesn't really work well at that time. But well, this is the first Shaky was embedded with a mobile system that can let him to go to different places with a camera, and then started to think about perception, about reasoning, about decision making, and all the things. And the recent trends now is that we're going to more complex robotic systems, such as humanoid, that you have already seen several of them in the videos on YouTube or so forth. So this is the first thing, which you might certainly not agree, but this is the way I think I see it. What's intelligence? So frankly speaking, I don't know what it means from an engineering and even the biological perspective. And I like to quote this saying from Dr. Dan Ariely from Duke University, and he was speaking about big data. It is exactly what I think about intelligence or artificial intelligence. So, as I don't know what human intelligence means, I don't know what its artificial counterparts means also. But as you can see, it shares common ground with big data. So I removed the first part of the sentence, but you could find it in internet if you are interested. But the thing is that everyone talks about it, nobody really knows how to do it. Everyone thinks everyone else is doing it, so everyone claims they are doing it. Therefore, I banned this term from my research and I will stop speaking about artificial intelligence right now, and of course from my papers, etc. And I will speak more about graspable things, which are autonomy, perception, and things that you could really, that we can model correctly well from the engineering perspective. So, as I said, this robotic evolved towards human-centered, where you have service robots engendered sharing the space with the human, as you could see from the previous talk, so the robots are not really hidden or far. The creation of multiple type of services, and then the service became, and the robot became customized to the service it has been designed for. And nowadays, robotic systems are centered toward human, but I will explain what really it means. It means especially that in terms of the correct requirements and the design, it's another perspective, it's another philosophy. Example, if you work close to human, then haptic touch is becoming something important, and many of the research in robotics now are trying to deal with this. As I said, reintegration in the industry with novel production line view, I will explain it later on in some slides. I will try to be fast because I made a talk for more longer time. So what the robotic augmentation is called, I said already that it's about physical capabilities, and the reason why we want to use robots is to get round of a handicap, of aging, and the quest for power also. But I like to classify robotics. You see when you read books that there are many ways to classify robots. But I think nowadays the best classification or taxonomy, if you have to make one, it has to do with the distance that separates the robot in the purpose of its functionalities from the human. So if the robot is far, is with a positive distance, like drones, mules, and mine sweeper, etc., you can have robots also that are close in contact with humans, like vehicles, exoskeleton, human extenders, and robots within human bodies, and it's mainly robotic or medical robotics. So I think that for the more the relation between the distance of the robot and the human is, it changes the way you have to program the robot, you have to see the robot, and you have to control it as well. So, as I said, the control strategy will depend a lot on the distance. Of course, if the robot is far, we have already well-established and mastered way of doing this through teleoperation, telepresence, shared autonomy. If the robot is at your contact, some approaches prove to be efficient, but we need to consider safety, transparency, apparent inertia, human contact, embedded power, etc. And if the robot is inside you, then obviously the things changes a whole way around. So let me now speak fully about some things which are common, which you know, and I give my personal opinion on that. I mean, you may disagree with them, of course, but I start with the exoskeleton. I personally think it's a personal opinion that it's a bad good idea, probably the best bad good idea robotics came with. So I think for rehabilitation it's okay, but I don't know whether you need to wear a robot to do good rehabilitation. But for other application, I think it should be consumed with moderation. The nature has its law, and this is the reason why, and the physics generally fixes the game rules. And basically, before doing systems like this, you better try also to understand how the nature is and why, if you have looked around, you could find being living or living beings which has exoskeletons. And basically, the biggest you know in the planet is this coconut crab, okay, or the rubber crab also, it is known under this name. And this is the greater, the largest animal you find with an exoskeleton. And the reason why you wouldn't find another animal is just, it's because it's impossible. It's impossible because basically if you have a bigger one, so the animal or this living being cannot live. But still roboticists are keeping trying to do something which is counter nature. And if you have tried yourself these systems, you'd realize that they are not that doing that well of what they claim to do. And in my opinion, it's not something that has to be taught this way. Probably if you have to design exoskeleton, you have to take into account the constraint that it should be soft at the beginning and then start to do systems which takes into account these constraints. There are also things by you, which I found very interesting, which goes online with this, but which I believe it's much more probably challenging, is to design supernumerary links. This is due to our colleague from IIT, and these pictures are a courtesy from Professor Azada. And these things are interesting because they put, they allow you to design robot that you could wear, and this is the robot which are in contact to the human, of course, to have an extra limb that allows you to help you to do tasks. So this is, for instance, a solution that is envisioned by Boeing to embed its worker inside the airplane. And the problem with this system is that the control interface is not easy to be done, and that I do not see what else we can do to control them better than a thought-based control or something which is, takes into account the application you are doing, and then it could be somehow be programmed to help you to do the task. So thought-based control, a few words on that. For me, it's more of a laboratory product than reality for the moment. Of course, these are the most famous, probably, picture you would find in internet, also as a movie. You see that this woman is capable of controlling the trajectory of the robot, and this one also, which is published in Nature. You have this DLR arm, which is feeding the woman to drink a Coke, and she's controlling the motion, of course, of these robots. The point is that these are doing the things in the wrong way. Basically, they're training a person to control each increment step of the trajectory of the robot. And it doesn't. I don't think that the brain does such kind of things. You don't control really the each increment of the trajectory of your hand. And if you take into account the orientation, it's becoming just very complex. It takes about months of trainings to get the results that you see here in the internet. So what alternative we can seek about? I don't think that person need to consider such a system as I take a robot, I plug it, and I try to control it. As at a low-level control. Basically, what we have been trying to do in recent years is to think, go around this problem and see it as a, in the perspective of trying to guess what the intention of the human is. If you want to do a very practical system that are useful, it and for those one, of course, you have to notice that in fact the electrodes are placed on the brain. And which, of course, you cannot use for normal or usual people. And then, if we can guess what the human intentions are and extract this from the brain, you can control the robot to do the task for you. I mean, we have to understand that if you have to design a system which is centered on human, you have to exploit best of what the robot can do with best of the human can do also, or we can get from the human. But for the moment, I agree that it's the problem why it's not done this way, it's just because it's complicated to extract from your mind what your intention will be. So instead of training a person to control each small step of the trajectory of the arm to do the task, so if we can get what the humanist wants to do, so we can just program the robot to do it for him. And we have to consider then other aspects that I will be talking about, which are the embodiment. So I will come to some of the research we have done along these lines. And you could see here a person controlling a whole humanoid robot by thought. And here we are using simple electrodes, of course, put in the brain, on the in the visual cortex, and then what we try to see if whether we can extract the intention of the person from the brain and then just program the robot to do the task for him. And then we check whether the person still feels embodied in this robot. It means if the user feels that the body of this robot is his own body. This has allowed researchers to develop a specific program. So here what you can see, okay, I will just let the video speak.
It's only a robot that you are operating at a distance, but the level of embodiment of the interface between the human and the robot should be in a way such that you feel that this robot is part of you. In the
case of this experiment... So here what we do is that we are trying to stimulate the brain and find the frequency of the object. The objects are recognized automatically in the scene with a normal vision system that can recognize objects in the scene, and then this system is embedded on the robot. If the robot, the object of interest appear in the camera field of view, they start to flicker at different frequencies, and we can know on which object the operator is focusing. And then we extract from the affordance what is the task to be done of this object, and we just program the robot to do it. This is the same thing with using ECOG system that we do with the hospital of the Asa Hikawa Medical in Japan. Oh, sorry, it's this video. Here we try to do whether we can do the same thing with having a more complicated person. Of course, this is a patient which we have embedded with ECOG system, and we applied exactly the same thing that we have applied. So try to guess what the intention is, and then just program the trajectory of the robot to do the things. So programming the trajectory is one thing. So I will just skip, and I have talked about this embodiment issue. So embodiment is really, well, it is misused generally in robotics. I mean, you find it, of course, in the literature, but it doesn't really mean what it is really in the people who are doing neuroscience and human science in general. So for the moment, the best we know in robotics is the telepresence. I mean, you control a system at a distance, and then you get the data back, and you stimuli the person in a master station, and you try to give him the feeling that he is remotely located. So basically you feed back the sound, you feed back the vision, you feed back the smell whatsoever, and also the tactile information when you touch objects at a distance. And that's all what robotics is about. And basically the people are trying to get the best of transparency, how we can do this with a high fidelity. But the question is, at what point you could probably feel that this robot is not a robot that you are controlling at a distance, but it's yourself, it's your body, it's part of your body. And this is what science of embodiment is about. As you could see, this is a very famous rubber hand illusion where in fact you put two hands, one is in rubber, the other one is your true hand, and then you brush the two hands together. At a certain point, you will really feel that that this rubber hand is part of your hand and it's your hand. And you feel that true that if someone came with a knife and then tried to get to this rubber hand, you tend to remove your hand in this way. So, and we are trying to port this in robotics because it's really important. Whatever technology from the experience we have, you do with a robot and human system. And you try, for instance, for tetraplegic, to try to tell them, okay, I have designed a very good limb for you, and then you have to use it and work with it. Because you do it on a paper, you do it in an engineering point of view, and everything should work perfectly well. And I will tell you from feedback I got from these persons, I mean, most of my colleagues work on that, is that generally it doesn't work. And the reason it doesn't work doesn't always is a problem of engineering, or is connected to some problem with your engineering. It's just that the person doesn't trust on it. And if the person doesn't trust on it, it will not work, even if on your thing it has to be working. So I will just give you now very a few things on the research we are undergoing. Of course, I have much to say, for instance, of this future of smart houses, whether you see a house as a distributed robot, or whether you see it or you automate the house by being encapsulated in one robot. So there is two big vision of how we would design this. I will skip this. This is a research that we started, and I will probably end by this one. In trying to program, it's more about fundamental issues of how to program the robot to take contacts with the environment and to be able to use the environment, not as obstacle as we do in robotics to be avoided, but it's obstacle that you could support your motion on it. And this was basically the start. So you can see here the robot is trying to learn how to use the environment to do acyclic non-gated motions. And I will just skip my voice. And just show you much more complicated things. And the idea is how you can program the robot to do this. And this was the starting of why we have a joint big research program with Airbus to port these humanoid robotics into a manufacturing. So this is what the manufacturing looks like. And you could see from this picture that it is very complicated to make like fixed-base robot, rail-ported robot, and the only solution we find after 1 year of discussion is to have humanoid operating because we don't need to we don't have to exclude humans. And as you can see, this is the today picture of robotics in manufacturing, and you have probably not noted, but inside this picture there are robots which are working here, here, okay, and probably there also. And they are, you see that this is the future of a production line. The robot and the human are not excluding working in the same working space, and I will stop my talk at this point. Thank you very much for listening. To the talk, and I can answer your question later on.
Thank you, Professor Hedder, for this very fascinating lecture. I assume somebody is bringing Ray Johnson's laptop here, or you're not? No? Okay, well, no, all right. Well, let me introduce our next speaker. Dr. Ray Johnson is a corporate executive with a proven track record of leading large organizations and developing and executing growth strategies, operational excellence in diverse business environments. And he served as the Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer of the Lockheed Martin Corporation. For those of you who don't know Lockheed Martin, it is one of the biggest high technology companies and defense contractors in the United States. And he oversaw the engineering, technology, production operations, global supply chain, and the program management and logistics and the sustainment generally. He's also the chief executive officer, or was the chief for Modern Technology Solutions of Alexandria, Virginia, held executive positions with Science Applications International Corporation, including senior vice president and general manager of the Advanced Concepts Business Unit. Dr. Johnson currently serves as an executive in a residence with Bessemer Venture Partners and is, in fact, starting QX branch under his leadership. And I don't know whether you want to get into QX branch, Ray, but we are all very eager to hear your take on robotics. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ray Johnson.
Ismail, thank you for the nice introduction. Distinguished guests, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, it's a real pleasure to be here. This is my first meeting with this organization, and it's really fascinating. I think the level of science and the level of detail is a credit to the organization and to all the wonderful speakers that have come. Robotics is a very interesting subject to me. As Ismail mentioned, I, for 9 years, was the Senior Vice President and Chief Technology Officer for Lockheed Martin, and I would argue with about 72,000 engineers in the company, it's one of the largest engineering and technology organizations in the world. And we, of course, have an interest in a lot of things, and robotics is one of them. Robotics, I think, is a bit different, though, because many high technology areas of research kind of start off in aerospace and defense in those applications. And you can look back at the history of from integrated circuits to other things, and also the space program. that they were really the origin for the work. And I think robotics is very different. Actually, robotics origins, I think, comes from, you know, we had a speaker talking about the work done in Japan, comes from concerns over aging and how might we supplement the people who are aging, or maybe even toys in other areas. So it came from, the origin, I think, came from a very different place. That having said that, organizations like DARPA in the United States, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, have in fact supported contests in robotics, such as the DARPA Robotics Challenge, whereby people bring their skills, they have a standard set of robots, and then people bring their skills to bear to have these robots perform essentially taking people out of buildings that are burning or other activities like that, so life support activities. But having said that, again, I think, and then there's space, of course, where a lot of things are done robotically, but most of this comes from a different origin. And so I want to talk a little bit about, and I think you've heard some of this from other speakers, robotics and biorobotics applications to the life sciences, which really is experiencing a huge expansion. Some would actually call it a revolution that's taking place right now. And I think if you look at the way technology comes to bear, you know, something as simple as your iPhone or your smartphone, it took many years of all these different elements of what the iPhone is today. You had to have communication, you had to have processing power, you got camera, you got all these different things that came together, and the convergence of them enabled the iPhone to be made. And I think the same is true really for robotics and the life sciences. There are a number of things that have come together. And so materials technology, huge advances there. Perception, power sources, more work to be done there, of course. And autonomy, machine learning or artificial intelligence, the word we can't use, that are enabling new classes of robotics in the life sciences, as well as other disciplines. And I think that's also the nature of robotics, is that there's a lot of sharing that goes between the various entities as developments are made. So current applications in life sciences, of course, include surgery, support to hospitals and laboratories, therapeutic robots, bionic prosthetics, exoskeletons, which I'll talk a little bit about our experience there, and advanced training systems for doctors and nurses. The application of robotics to surgeries is not new, but the capabilities, experience, and associated benefits are actually becoming much more advanced. And we're seeing that in the occurrence of smaller incisions, more consistent outcomes, shorter stays, and in many cases, even lower costs. I just saw an article this morning that talked about the precision of robotic surgery being actually much greater than that of a human in terms of reproducibility, so we're taking advantage of that. I'll talk about it in a moment, but I think if you think about the difference between teleoperation, where most of, I like your greater than zero, zero, and less than zero analogy here, but you think of teleoperations, a lot of what's done in robotic surgery especially is teleoperations. And so as we move beyond teleoperations to machine learning or artificial intelligence applications, that'll have implications for rural areas in the world. In the area of laboratory automation, again, it's the precision of the robot. It's the ability to do things over and over and over again without getting fatigued, without getting tired. So that's from, and so pharmaceutical and medical device manufacturing is very interested in this area. To the trends, smaller footprints, higher throughput, and of course, improved operations for a variety of areas to include blood sampling and other in the pharmaceutical and drug discovery process. Speaking of that, there's an increased interest in robotics and pharmaceutical and scientific research itself because in the ability to actually produce lower cost pharmaceuticals. If you do consider machine learning and AI, then there are additional aspects of drug discovery that can be included in that rather than the repetitious part. You can actually involve the machine learning component in the drug discovery process as well and feed that. Advances in materials, I mentioned that as one of the convergence factors, and that's really at both the macro and the nano scales. Both are important. And in the nano area, I just read again an article the other day that said if you want to encourage your children to move into any particular discipline, of course engineering is always one that's mentioned, but chemistry. because chemistry is affecting every part of our life, and chemistry is being applied to material science in ways that are really changing the way we think about materials. And we don't have to live with the materials that are that nature offered now. We can actually engineer our own materials. There's a project at MIT called the Materials Genome that's allowing us to engineer materials that take on vast new properties. Those are being applied to robotics. And so in some of the videos, you'll notice that robots have a tendency to have very hard surfaces, and the hard surface interaction with objects can be a problem. And so now softer but firm materials are being developed, more human-like manipulation from robots, and more natural prosthetics, as I mentioned. The improvement of diagnostic methods is supported by nanotechnology as well, and to include improved drug formulations and possibly the administration of drugs at the nano level to specific areas in the body, to include even cells. Greater analytical capability is also provided by nanotechnology, data quality, less sample volume, storage, and screening of molecular cells and tissue libraries as well. Now let's talk about exoskeletons. Exoskeletons do continue to improve, and I understand the point about it being the best bad idea, but I think that there can be some things that can overcome that. I attended a meeting in Phoenix, Arizona, sponsored by the Wearable Robotics Association. And what I saw in that was, actually within Lockheed Martin, we developed an exoskeleton. And the exoskeleton's main problem, as you mentioned, there are other animals that have skeletons and they power themselves, but as we know, bugs eat, right? And so the problem with the exoskeleton is really power. But if you can provide power, then the separate remote operation becomes very difficult, but in a factory environment or supplementing the human, those aspects of the exoskeleton can be very powerful. So we're seeing that exoskeleton applications to even service robots from a mobile servant, physical assistant, and a person carrier robot does have applications. And if we ever get the energy problem solved, then we'll be able to move beyond that. But I think what I saw was spinal cord injury victims and military people who had been coming back with spinal injuries by the hundreds are gaining a lot of real support from the exoskeleton, even though, again, from a battery point of view, an energy point of view, you have to charge it and you can't use it very long, still provides tremendous benefits there. So biorobotics, that's a term that largely covers fields like cybernetics, bionics, and now often even applied to genetic engineering, which are expanding rapidly. So on the biomechanical and bioengineered side, you're seeing the development of muscles, tissues, and organs that are even being engineered. And I think there's a blend that's happening between the bioengineering and 3D manufacturing, advanced manufacturing. We're seeing tissue manufacturing as well, and muscles and tissues and organs, as I said. The Internet of Things and wearable devices, where we actually separate robotics and cybernetics and how this all works together, I think we'll see how it works out, but I think IoT or the Internet of Things or wearables is going to change the way we think about this. I'm on the board of a company called United Sciences, and the short version of United Sciences is that they have maybe a device that is a solution to part of what you saw in the professor's video that we just saw. And in that video, you saw when you want to do brain research, you have to wear electrodes on the skull typically to capture the brain information, the various waves. Well, United Sciences, what is their expertise? Their expertise is actually in hole measurement. And so they have a laser-based device that gives you optical wavelength accurate measurements of the human ear. They measure other holes as well in manufacturing, but the really interesting one to me is the human ear. So you measure the human ear, and it develops this very precise 3D model. And from that very, very precise 3D model, you can build devices that go in the ear, from earbuds to listen to music to hearing aids, etc. But one of the interesting things that you can do is you can build an earbud that has various sensors on it. And the sensors that have been demonstrated under development include EEG, EKG, pulse, of course, oxygen level in the blood, possibly glucose, as well as the three-dimensional motion in a gyro compass and all those things. Why is that interesting? That's interesting, and I would defer to people in the audience or in the room who are more expert than I am in this, but they are experts in the company that know this well, and that is that the brain signals tend to be a very low-level signal, so the signal-to-noise ratio is quite low, and with anything that has a signal-to-noise ratio that's low, any noise can perturb the outcome. And so as you think about electrodes on the head, skull caps, other things, you get motion artifacts, and the motion artifacts add to the noise and create problems. And so by being in the ear, so close to the brain, kind of connected to the head, it reduces those brain artifacts, and so therefore the signal to noise ratio tends to be higher. And so there's actually, you may be familiar with this term, there's a Kickstarter campaign that's in place right now to encourage research in the brain around these devices. So I think that'll be interesting. One of the areas of difficulty when you think about robotics and all the areas that we've talked about, especially in building devices like exoskeletons or others, are the standards. Standards range in the areas from safety to interoperability, and you see safety standards emerging first, interoperability standards emerging later, but the lack of standards and the lack of standards bodies in this area can be a real problem. And if you contrast it to how standards have enabled markets in some cases and actually disabled markets in some cases, I think the classic example is VHS versus beta, where beta, for those of you in the room, these are recorders, and beta had a better device and a smaller tape, and et cetera, et cetera. VHS was clunkier, it didn't work as well, but they got into the marketplace and essentially won by the numbers. And so without standards, those kinds of things can happen. So let's spend a few minutes as we end the conversation here about future applications to include remote surgery, nanorobotics, and repair of broken bones, administered medication, and then robotic wearables that act as sensors that can support continuous health monitoring, which is very important as we try to take more control of our health and get out of chronic care modes. So telehealth will continue to expand and provide medical care to rural people around the world. I saw some of this in India. I've traveled to India a lot, 26 times in the last 9 years, and seen a lot of work. What really needs to happen, and where technology plays an important role, is we need to move to donation-based businesses to sustainable businesses. And one of the enabling factors in moving to a sustainable business for example, supporting rural telemedicine, is technologies that have a price point that enable the business model to close. And that's what's beginning to happen, so that's a very good thing. Again, as artificial intelligence, deep learning, machine learning, autonomy, as those things reach higher levels, you can think about improved remote diagnosis, remote treatment, administration of drugs, and possibly even remote surgeries, maybe through teleoperation. Maybe you have a skilled technician, but not actually the surgeon on site. Assistive robotics were for the elderly, where we blend robotics, information technology, and communications to meet this important need. And if you look at the demographics of Japan, and I'm sure that's part of the reason why you're studying, you're doing research there, but Japan faces a demographics crisis. It's nothing less than a crisis, and without importing skilled workers or others, they're going to really, if you do the math, by 2300, there are no Japanese. That's kind of the way it works without a change, and so they have to address this problem. 3D printed tissues and organs will add to this biorobotics revolution. The drug industry also is facing a tremendous challenge, and the drug industry's challenge is that the blockbuster model doesn't work anymore. And as we move away from small molecule chemistry into genomics and proteomics, you begin to see the application of robotics in other areas as well. So I will mention QBranch, the company that I am executive director in. QBranch is a data analytics and quantum computing company. And so the linkage between data analytics, machine learning, and how it can apply to robotics is very important. Why quantum computing? Quantum computing, without going into a lot of detail, operates on qubits, and it uses entanglement, and it basically is taking quantum mechanical properties that you usually only see at the microscale microscopic scale, and you're applying them in the macro world. It's very difficult to keep them in that state. That's why we don't see quantum mechanical properties around us, because they're easily destroyed. But there are a number of companies around the world that are building now, actually, quantum computers. And why are they important? And they're important because, number one, they have a revolutionary speed up because they perform simultaneous operations, so it's 2 to the n, where every qubit you add doubles the compute power, where n is the number of qubits, so that's powerful, and they operate simultaneously. But maybe even more important for machine learning is they are probabilistic machines rather than deterministic machines. And so when we think about the way humans operate, if you were to try to write a computer program in a deterministic language, in a von Neumann architecture, for you to get down to have coffee, and all the things that you would have to do and how difficult that would be, and the if-then and decisional statements, conditional statements, would be very difficult to get you there. However, if you think about the world probabilistically, which we do, when you're going to walk across the street and you want to cross traffic in Alexandria, which you know is difficult, you use probability measures to figure out how to get there, and that's where quantum computers, I think, can really help machine learning and be applied to robotics in a big way. So I'm a big fan of robotics and biorobotics. I think that they are in a revolutionary state right now, again, through the convergence of all the things we talked about. And I think they're going to offer improved outcomes for more people around the world, really empower people around the world, empower medical professionals around the world to do their jobs better, and hopefully in a more affordable way, and meeting the price point that the people around the world can afford through these closing business models. Ishmael, thank you again for the invitation to come and speak with you. I really enjoyed being here. Thank you.
As the laptop is being linked up, let me introduce Professor Rob Shepard, who is the Director of the Bionics Institute and Head of the Medical Bionics Department at the University of Melbourne, way down under. And the Department of the University of Melbourne, in the 1980s, he led the preclinical team that demonstrated the safety and efficacy of cochlear's bionic ear in both adults and children. For those of you who don't know, these cochlear implants have been a blessing to a lot of people who had hearing problems. And more recently, his team developed the prototype Bionic Eye as part of an Australia-wide collaboration, Bionic Vision Australia, to develop a commercial Bionic Eye. And I know from many of my friends who have had cochlear implants how grateful they are to you and to your team, and maybe some of those who also suffer from vision problems will one day be equally grateful to you as well. So welcome, Rob Shepard, Director of the Bionics Institute.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's an honor for me to be at the Great Library of Alexandria. It's for the first time in Egypt, and it's a wonderful conference. So I'm going to change the track a little bit. I'm not going to talk about robotics. I'm going to talk about what we call medical bionics, neural prostheses, neural interfaces. My presentation will consist of an introduction to medical bionics. What is it? And a little bit of history about how this technology was developed. Present some of the commercial devices that are out there now making significant differences to the quality of life in millions of patients around the world. Provide a very brief overview of some of the current research being done both in our laboratory and laboratories around the world. Medical bionics is a rapidly expanding sector of medical research. And then conclude with a few important points about issues associated with these devices. So the introduction to medical bionics. These devices consist of electrode arrays placed close to or on neural tissue or excitable tissue. They either stimulate neural tissue, as you can see on the left. Examples are stimulating the auditory nerve in profoundly deaf patients, or stimulating retinal ganglion cells in patients that are profoundly blind, or stimulating the central nervous system in Parkinson's patients to minimize tremor associated with Parkinson's. Or, on the right, to record from neural activity, to record from the brain, to record from the nerve, to use that information to control, for example, brain-computer interfaces. Our work at the Bionics Institute consists of three main areas, three main themes: bionic hearing, cochlear implants, bionic vision, retinal prostheses, and what we call neurobionics, which is devoted to recording or stimulating from the central nervous system. And I'll present some of that work and some work from other laboratories today. But first, a little bit of history. I noticed a number of young people in the room, so they won't recognize the device on the left, but many of us will. That's a valve. And up until the 1950s and early 1960s, it was the only way to amplify electrical signals. The valve is large, requires a lot of power, is extremely delicate, generates a lot of heat, and there's no way you could implant a valve in a human body. So hence the first medical bionics device is shown on the right. First heart pacemaker, 1956. His heart pacemaker consisted of a large trolley of electronic circuitry that he had to wheel around, as you can see in that slide, consisting of valves. That trolley of electrical circuitry was connected via cable passing through his skin to the heart, where it provided the electrical impulses to allow the heart to beat. So it was absolutely a life-saving device, but not a high quality of life life-saving device. And by the way, he was always regulated by this very strict nurse to make sure that that cable didn't come out of a stimulator. Then the revolution in electronics occurred, and that revolution started in the late 1940s, but in the form of a development of a transistor, a device that is much, much smaller, much, much more robust, generates much, much less heat, and can be implanted in the human body. So by the mid-1960s, engineers were using these devices, these transistors, in developing fully implantable medical bionics devices. And the image on the right is one of the first implantable heart pacemakers, consisting of a number of batteries, four or five transistors, completely enclosed in an epoxy resin. The epoxy resin is very important. It's a hermetic seal. It's a seal that prevents fluid going into the electronic circuit and destroying the circuit. So these devices could be implanted above the chest cavity and allow patients to walk and move in a very normal situation. They're a revolution in the development of bionics. And since then, the revolution has only continued. And that really occurred with the development of integrated circuits in the 1970s. So now, not only can we develop devices with four or five transistors, we can develop devices with hundreds of thousands of transistors, making these medical bionics devices incredibly powerful, like the cochlear implant you can see on the right. Again, it's got a hermetic seal. It's encased with titanium. So in this case, the titanium is welded together to protect and seal the electronics from fluid ingress. But these devices are so sophisticated that not only can they stimulate with 22 electrodes that are inserted into the inner ear, but they can also record from neurons in the inner ear and send that information back to the outside world, thanks to the advances in electronic engineering. So what is a common state of the art? Where are we at with commercial devices? Here's three very common commercial medical bionics devices. for heart pacemaker, implanted in over 600,000 patients each year around the world. Huge industry. Cochlear implants, implanted in over 400,000 patients around the world, giving the gift of hearing to children as young as 3 months of age and adults as old as 90 years of age. And deep brain stimulation, currently implanted in about 250,000 patients around the world, treating the symptoms particularly of Parkinson's disease. So the cochlear implant, the work that we developed at Melbourne, the implantable part of a cochlear implant consists of this device that I showed you before, and it's implanted, the stimulator is implanted in the mastoid bone behind the ear, and the surgeon drills down through the mastoid to insert 22 fine platinum electrodes into the spiral-shaped inner ear of profoundly deaf people. These patients get no benefit from conventional hearing aids. There's no hair cells or very few hair cells in their cochlea. The cochlea, of course, is a spiral shape, and we stimulate the 22 electrodes to take advantage of what's called the cochleotopic organization of the inner ear. So when we stimulate electrodes in the apex of the cochlea, our patients perceive a low pitch sensation. As we stimulate electrodes in the more basal region of the cochlea, patients perceive a higher pitch sensation. So we're able to convey basic information about pitch and timing of human speech that the human brain then uses to understand the complexities of human speech. Many, not all, but many cochlear implant patients can use these devices very effectively, even using a mobile phone, where you've got a reduced signal quality and certainly no lip reading. So these devices have been extremely successful. The external part of the device consists of something that looks like a hearing aid, which records the acoustic signal, the acoustic environment, and sends that information across the skin using wireless technology to the implant device. This device also has an onboard computer to determine which particular electrode needs to be stimulated at a particular point based on the frequency of incoming stimulation. This is some images of some children, profoundly deaf children, using the cochlear implant for the first time. So as I said, this device can be used in very, very young children and in adults, giving the gift of hearing. Another very successful device has been deep brain stimulation for Parkinson's disease. Essentially, a stimulator is placed under the skin, over the thoracic cavity, with a lead wire system that passes under the skin to electrodes that neurosurgeons implant deep within the brain to alleviate the symptoms of Parkinson's disease. These devices do not treat Parkinson's disease, but they obviously give an improved quality of life.
The probe that is placed into the brain, I understand, comes level with the top of the nose and the ear. And it is connected to a battery in my chest, under the skin in my chest here. And this is controlled. I can control the amount of the voltage going in. I can control the length of time that the pulse is, and I can identify the number of times per second that it goes in. And I'll turn myself off now.
You'll hear a little ping. The device is now turned off. Normally, you'd use this device 24/7.
So one of the problems, not only as you appreciate, is that you can't do very much for yourself. Well, of course, your hygiene has to be done. But because my concentration now is up to 90% of my tremor and trying to control it, and I'm thinking of the word Parkinson's all the time, I'm not concentrating on my conversation with you at all.
Notice his leg is also tremor. He's going to turn his device back on in a minute, and again you'll hear a ping indicating that the stimulator's now back on.
Okay.
Stimulator's on. So obviously these patients have to use these devices 24/7.
You can see this quite.
But you can see the significant improvement in quality of life with these devices. So, as I said at the outset, this technology, this medical bionics technology, is rapidly expanding. There's many research organizations and small startup companies around the world developing very exciting medical bionics devices. Here's just a few. Functional electrical stimulation to allow paraplegics to stand and even walk for short periods of time. Brain-computer interfaces, we've already heard about that, and I'll talk to you a little bit more about one of those devices in a minute. Vision prostheses to address blindness. Neurobionics, the same type of deep brain stimulation technology that I've just shown you, to be used in patients with very severe drug-resistant depression, pain management, and for treatment of drug-resistant seizure. Vestibular prostheses that can monitor balance for patients with intractable vertigo, and vagal nerve stimulation to treat inflammatory bowel disease. These are just some of the projects that are underway in labs around the world. The highlighted projects are projects that we're undertaking at Melbourne. So let's briefly look at the bionic eye and where we are with the bionic eye. There's over 60 million people in Europe and US who have significant vision loss. Our device rests on the fact that we need to be able to stimulate the optic nerve through stimulating the retinal ganglion cells. So we are developing a device that will, first of all, address patients with retinitis pigmentosa. The photoreceptors degenerate, but the optic nerve is still intact. We anticipate that in the future, we'll also be able to address some forms of macular degeneration with this sort of device. Other forms of blindness where the optic nerve degenerates would not be suitable for this type of device. So we've developed an electrode array. It's made of the same materials, medical grade silicon and platinum electrodes, exactly the same materials as cochlear implants. So the regulatory bodies will be very comfortable with this type of material because it's been used in humans for 40, 50 years. This is an X-ray image of one of our first patients. We've had three patients in a two-year clinical trial, and you can see the electrode array that's been inserted behind the patient's eye and the 40 electrodes in that device. We've considered very carefully where we should place our electrode. Some groups place their electrode on the retina, close to the retinal ganglion cells that you want to stimulate. But it's a very invasive surgery, and the retina is a very, very delicate structure. So we've opted to place our electrode in what's called this suprachoroidal position between the choroid, the blood supply to the retina, and the white of the eye, the sclera. So this is relatively straightforward surgical procedure and doesn't involve the surgical invasion of the eye. Takes about 3 hours in human surgery. We've done extensive preclinical animal studies to demonstrate that the device is both safe and biocompatible. This is a histological image of an eye of an animal. There's the optic nerve there. This is the region where the electrode array was implanted. Blown up here, and this is the retina, this is the sclera. After long-term implantation and stimulation, we see very little, no adverse effects. So our animal studies allowed us then to go on to do a two-year clinical trial in three patients. What do these patients see? So this is an infrared image of one of the patient's eyes. There's the optic disc, there's the electrode array. There's each of the individual electrodes. When we stimulate an individual electrode, the patient sees a phosphene, a white dot. If we increase the stimulus level, that dot gets brighter and larger. Importantly for us, as we stimulate different electrodes, those phosphenes appear in retinotopically different regions of the patient's visual map, which allows us then, using computer technology, to generate very simple shapes with our prosthetic device, such as you see in this slide.
So today, Diane's doing experiments where we're having a set of obstacles in front of her on the ground, and she needs to move from the back part of this environment through to the front part, and we're looking at how long it takes her to pass through that pass and how many collisions she has with obstacles or brushes against the wall.
This lady's so been
she's wearing
for over 20 years.
Backpack computer, which is attached to a head-mounted camera incorporating a depth sensor, and the backpack is processing that and then doing the vision processing of that and then putting up the set of things that we want to have stimulated on the electrode array for her to then gain an impression of what she's seeing in the image.
Oh, this is, you can see a reason for the bionic eye. You can see that there's a practical use for it. It's just, it's really good.
So that was a prototype device. You'd never be able to sell a device that looked like that. The backpack alone with the batteries and the visual processor weighed about 12 kilograms. What we're doing at the end of this year is developing a device. We've developed a device that'll have a video camera on glasses, similar video processing, image processing that then transmits to an implantable device like a cochlear implant, a lead wire, so there's the video camera, vision processor, communication across the skin, implant stimulator with a lead wire system that goes to 44 electrodes to stimulate retinal ganglion cells. And we anticipate that will occur late this year. We're also doing other projects in terms of what we call neurobionics. We're developing improved devices for deep brain stimulation for not only Parkinson's disease, but for obsessive compulsive disorder. And in association with neurologists at one of our leading hospitals, developing devices that record from the brain so that we can predict the onset of epileptic seizure and warn the patient that a seizure is about to occur, and not only warn the patient, but also have technology that allow the device to ring the patient's carer and the patient's neurologist. This work is still quite early, but we anticipate clinical trials in the next 18 months. I'll talk briefly about brain-computer interfaces. Our lab doesn't work in this area, but it's been mentioned before in this morning's session. And this is one example of brain-computer interfaces. This is work done at Brown University in the United States using electrode arrays, very small electrode arrays of up to 100 electrodes that are inserted in the patient's motor cortex. Now, these patients are quadriplegic patients as a result of high-level spinal cord injury. Importantly, their motor cortex still functions normally. So these electrodes are placed in the region that controls arm movement, and the patient can think of moving right arm versus left arm and generate completely unique and different neural signatures with those thoughts. And those unique neural signatures can be used to drive devices as simple as turning lights off and on, turning television sets off and on, or turning robotic limbs off and on. And this is a video from their work. We've seen a still image of that earlier today. This woman is using this robotic device for the first time. She's used other robotic arms, but this is the first time she's used this device. She's been paralyzed for 15 years. She's used her electrode. She's had her electrode for 5 years. It's still a prototype device. You can see it's got a large amplifier on the outside, so it's fully wired. It hasn't got wireless technology at this stage, but they're working on that. And this is the first time in 15 years that this woman has provided herself with a drink. Small step for her, but a small step from our perspective, but a major step for her. She's enjoying that drink. So, conclusions. The field is rapidly expanding, but there's a number of lessons we've learned along the way. The work must be multidisciplinary. We've heard about the importance of multidisciplinary research throughout the conference. If I let my engineers work in isolation, this is what we'd get. They must work with surgeons, they must work with clinicians, they must work with neuroscientists. It's incredibly important. But the multidisciplinary team is even larger than that. It's even larger than that because we have to work with business officers, we have to work with entrepreneurs that scientists have traditionally not had experience with working. Secondly, we must pay huge respect to the human brain. This technology is incredibly crude. For example, we're applying 22 electrodes into the inner ear, whereas to provide hearing, whereas a normal human inner ear has 1,500 inner hair cells that would do the same job. So it's testament to the plastic brain that these patients can extract this crude information and use it as effectively as they do. And finally, there are significant barriers that we all face commercializing our technologies. Funding is typically available for basic research, but getting that funding to develop successful commercialization is very, very difficult. And as I said before, you need a number of other skill sets to be able to successfully commercialize your technology. So that's a big challenge for many groups developing these sorts of devices. I'd like to acknowledge our staff and our collaborators and our funding agencies, Australian Government, the National Institutes of Health, DARPA, and the Gunnar Pass and Rodney Williams Memorial Foundation. Before I completely finish, if you're interested in this work, we have a conference late in November in beautiful Brisbane, Queensland. And if you're interested, you'd be more than welcome to go onto the website and find out more information about it. Thanks very much.
I'd first like to start by thanking our speakers, each and every one, for this fascinating presentation, series of presentations, really. And I have my own questions for each one to get them started, and I hope that they will also get started into a debate among themselves. But if I may, I will start with Dr. Abdulrahman Khidr and ask a question on the observation that you made between, which will later on come back again to a discussion with Ray on exoskeletons, but the one that I noted was that you felt that trying to teach someone to control every step of the way of an action by a robot is really a very unproductive way to do it. It takes an enormous amount of effort. And actually, we don't think that way. So the most immediate example that came to my mind is how we humans throw a ball at something. And we really don't think about how I'm going to exactly control the speed. But you get the biofeedback when you see that the ball has fallen short or has gone too far. And I don't know how much I'm adjusting the strength of my arm or the angle of the throw, but I do it just by getting that biofeedback and work back at it. In your systems, do you have biofeedback built in? Is there a way of teaching robots in the same fashion that humans, for example, learn to throw a ball?
Yes, that's a very interesting question. It's clearly that you haven't
see the problem pretty deeply. I'm really impressed by the thoroughness of the question. Yes, actually, the feedback is very important. It's true that when you do, you give the trajectory, as you see in the last video, it was very, very nice, because then we could see really if what are the consequences when you try to control the robot. Sometimes it gets okay, sometimes it gets back, and it's slow. But if you could get that this lady wanted to drink the bottle, then of course the robot can be programmed very easily with also a closed loop perception of how to go to grasp the bottle and bring the bottle right to her mouth. But it is important to keep the embodiment. The embodiment means that she has to feel that she is under the control of the robot, even though the robot can do the task, even though you can throw the things. You need to keep this kind of feedback, that she has the impression that she is still under the control. Otherwise, you will break the embodiment. So, of course, you have the vision feedback, and you have the possibility, of course, to act on the robot. And we could, some others have, we tried already on tetraplegics to have still tactile stimuli feedback to make the person feel that you are under the control of the robot.
Yeah, we see the same thing with visual prostheses. Those bionic eye patients, initially, they regarded it as a prosthetic vision. But during the course of the 2 years of using the device, they came back to us and said, we're seeing this through our eyes now. So it's the plasticity of the brain and using these technologies over and over again that is I think very important.
Well,
Ron, you want to come in? And I was going to ask you whether this plasticity actually also comes into behavior, which is something that you were controlling, Ron.
Well, I'd like to add that there's been tremendous work, and unfortunately I can't remember her name. It's a professor in, I believe, EPFL in Switzerland, who's done, she's done remarkable work in learning by demonstration. Exactly. She's throwing and catching in incomprehensible ways, from my perspective, without even tapping into the human nervous system at this particular case. So the progress in machine learning has been quite remarkable. Often enabled by advances in computation. Deep learning, for example, has been around Fukushima's work in the 50s and 60s, epitomized in the 70s when he built the neocognitron, led to just winning AlphaGo right now, winning the Go,
being
the world expert.
True.
So machine learning, even without necessarily tapping directly into the human nervous system, still just by observing, an observation can still pick up a lot.
See, I think there's a hybrid nice case here. And the hybrid nice case is, and I'll relate it to what I would think of as symbology. And so the brain, I don't think, has to control every aspect, because if you can symbolize, I want to throw the ball, through the equivalent of deep learning and the equivalent of muscle memory. So the brain, to your point, when you say throw the ball, the brain says, I want to throw the ball, but you have muscle memory that you've learned how to throw the ball. The robot can take that on, right? The robot can, do through deep learning, learn, and actually maybe faster than a human, because it gets feedback from perception about what's accurate and what's not accurate. Doesn't have any trouble duplicating that. So then the brain can symbolically say, I want to throw the ball, and the robot can take it from there. So I think there's a hybrid approach.
Well, while you have the microphone, let me ask you two other questions that came out from the differences perhaps between your presentation and that of some of the others. One, I note that you have an interest in exoskeletons, which seems to differ from Dr. Hedder for one thing. And the other one, of course, is the actual way in which quantum computing may affect that. So could you comment on those two points?
Okay. I think they're separate. I don't know that.
They're
separate questions. So in the first case, I think I'm probably, I don't think our disagreements are that large. I think my belief the best bad idea, I think it is a good idea in a way, because I watched patients who couldn't walk, who were supported in a way that enabled them to do things that they couldn't do. And so from that perspective, I think continuing the research in this area, especially through advanced materials, through maybe composites, lighter weight, high strength materials, getting the getting the wearability and the usability and ductility and all those things so that it becomes easier for humans to use. And then, of course, the power sources continues to be a problem. But I think there's so much benefit that comes from this, and I have the belief that ultimately, you know, hopefully we'll come up with other sources of energy that enable us to at least have longer duration. So I don't think our disagreements are that great, but I'll let
the professor comment. Can I just ask a question? You all remember, I suppose, the movie Avatar?
Yeah.
Are we going to see fighting machines with basically exoskeletons expanded multiple times the way we saw in that movie?
I don't believe so. I don't think.
The constraints?
I think the constraints that we talked about are going to limit that. And you've seen future visions, I guess, of fighting forces, even people speculating that might happen. I don't think that's going to happen for the reasons we talked about. And then the quantum computing, I'll just give a few more comments on that, I guess. I actually purchased in my previous position the first available, commercially available quantum computer through a company, Canadian company called D-Wave. Ron and I were talking about whether or not that actually is a quantum computer, whether it displays quantum properties. It does display quantum properties. There are arguments about whether it's actually a quantum computer. Those weren't important to me. What they essentially did, and I give them credit for this, is if you wait for, you know, letting perfect be the enemy of good enough, if you wait for a perfect qubit, then they wouldn't have a commercially available quantum computer today. What D-Wave did was they engineered, based on not so good qubits, they engineered a system, and they went through the roughly 10 years of learning from 5 years ago when they put the first one out to the two upgrades that have occurred in the 256 to 512 to 1024 machine. They learned so much about engineering and how do you get something to operate at 17 millikelvin, right? So how do you operate this chip at 17 millikelvin, keep it that cold, have it operate, and then the things they learned from that I think are credit and will help the ecosystem of quantum computing. Now that that's happened, let's advance the quality of the qubits. Work being done at University of New South Wales, Michelle Simmons' work. I was just there a week ago, visiting her. Work being done at the University of Maryland, Chris Monroe's lab, work being done. There are many areas of different kinds of work at Oxford University. Different kind of work that's being done to develop very, very high quality qubits. I think that my view is that when we get the physics underpinning correct, because of the work that's been done in the engineering, that will more rapidly engineer systems. So I don't think we're 20 years away. I think we're 5 years away from emerging systems and 10 years away from systems that can handle fairly complex challenges. And you know, there's a famous Bill Gates quote, and it says, we always overestimate the advances that will occur in 2 years, and we underestimate the advances that will occur in 10 years. So I'm hopeful that we'll see. And just to answer your, I guess it was Ron's question as well, we're not building hardware in QBranch. We are a software company, so we're building software for a variety of different hardware architectures.
But you said the D-Wave computer, although imperfect qubits, still does display quantum features, superposition, entanglement, etc.
It does, and it is not, nor is it intended to be a universal quantum computer. Think of it as, early stages. In early stages, Google, I purchased one in my previous position. NASA, Google purchased one. Los Alamos National Laboratory just purchased one. In Google's work that they published 3 months ago, or something like that. For a particular algorithm, so the D-Wave is really good at optimization. So for a particular optimization algorithm, for particular conditions, it showed a 10 to the 8th improvement over a single core classical machine. So very special case, and not to be generalized, but it did demonstrate, again, we're in the baby steps here, it did demonstrate that for a particular case, it did show dramatic improvement.
Well, Ron, you've been working on the behavioral side, if I may say, while people have been working on the physical motion side. Can we see the two coming together as well?
The behavioral and the physical and the emotional?
Well, physical action.
They are all together. I can't see them actually being separated. From the very inception of the work that I was dealing with, we studied animals in their natural environment, which is the science of ethology as the basis for our work. Initially starting with frogs and toads, graduating to praying mantids under NSF and joint work with Mexico, looking at human beings, among others, but going to canines with IBO. I studied dog and human behavior in that context because it's really crucially important to acknowledge human behavior as well, too, if you want these systems to work around humans. So we studied not only dog behavior, but dog owner behavior as well to ensure that we have an ability to fill this ecological niche, which for robots to succeed, they have to find that particular place within the world. And we've continued to explore in a variety of different domains. The most recent ongoing work which we have is now under ONR funding. We're looking at what we call slow bots, which are really slow robots that are modeled after the tree sloth and an animal most of you haven't heard called the slow loris. And you
might the three-toed sloth, come on.
Part of it is if you want a robot to be out in the wild, or actually for precision agriculture, out in the plants for months, if not years, you have to manage your energy effectively, which these do. And nature somehow has found a place for these animals that are incredibly slow. It doesn't make any sense. I mean, any predator could come up and take advantage of them. There's all kinds of little anecdotes. Maybe another talk when I come back here, I'll share with you some of the work that we're making.
Indeed, yes, I think there's a lot to be said, and there's a whole range of other issues dealing with robotics that include animal mimicry and natural mimicry. Exactly.
Ron, I have a question for you that when I was listening to your presentation I thought of, and that was, people have developed avatars and we look for various uses for avatars. Do you think that in addition to the robot interaction where you try to get your emotions through the robot as an intermediary, what about the use of avatars to help with the display of emotions?
Right. Well, it speaks to the question where we may part company a little bit as well, too, to my colleague here as well, is the notion of embodiment. Embodiment in the context of most roboticists' perspective, at least from my side, deals with the physical presence of the robot in the world as compared to a computer screen or something else. And studies have been shown that that actually makes a difference in the way in which people perceive these kinds of platforms. Watching a TV screen versus actually having an animate agent which can physically interact with you if needs be changes the game a little bit. So I'm not saying that benefits might not be accrued, but I believe the physical presence is the key factor to try and address these issues from human behavior.
Okay, I think that's a very good point on both sides. If I may ask a slightly different question, which is really the notion, and I think you mentioned the iPhone. What strikes me, and you mentioned now the slow bots in the field, the interaction between humans and robotic machines, whether they're shaped like little humans or they're shaped like insects or whatever is not the issue right now. It's how you interact with them. Now, for years, a number of the people here in the audience and myself have been involved in development issues. And back in the 70s and 80s, there was a very wrong notion of what was called appropriate technology. Appropriate technology being interpreted as being dumbed down, simplified technology. And it turns out, I think, that it's clear now by the mobile phone that you can have very sophisticated technology that has enormous penetration in some of the poorest parts of the world, as long as the human-machine interface is simple and intuitive, and the machine itself is encased in such a way that it is robust and does not need lots of technicians working around it. Now, as we look at the kind of work being done, the implantation work implies that once it's reduced and in a resin encased and so on, you can put it inside a person. But do you foresee the extent to which these machine-human interfaces with semi-autonomous or autonomous robots will be one day accessible to the poorest farmers in the world, just as the smartphone today is. Despite the complexity of the technology of the smartphone, the user interface is easy, it's robust, does not need technicians around, and therefore its penetration has been lightning fast. Over 3 billion people now have mobile phones in even the most remote areas, and in Kenya, the M-Pesa is now using it as a parallel and duplicate banking system from the poorest neighborhoods to the most remote areas. So can any of you foresee that the autonomous robots can interact with humans in a way that mimics what I mentioned about the mobile phones?
Let me take a stab at that. First of all, the ability is not so much the iPhone. For people, people go to the interface instead of the interface coming to the people. Yeah. It's incredible how, even if you design a not necessarily perfect interface, people will adapt and be able to use that. That speaks to the incredible intelligence that human beings have to be able to, if there's value to be achieved, they will find a way to be able to get to that particular point. But I agree, it's crucially important that we find ways to make this technology available to not only the first world, but the third world. Part of it is interface design. There's work going on in speech and recognition and understanding. Well, you've got Siri right now. I don't know how many languages that works in, but the economic viability is still a major challenge. There was I don't remember, was it a, how cheap, was it a $5 computer that was supposed to go everywhere?
$100, initially, Nicholas Negroponte. Yeah. And they wanted a $100 computer, but yeah, it's getting there.
But everyone's got an iPhone, you see, so they don't have they have a computer. But
they do.
It's different. Their cell phone right now, not the project that was initially designed. And they paid a whole lot more for it, and probably for the service, I would suspect. So, yes, it is entirely possible that those systems should, not only could go out there, but should go out there as well, too, to assist with humanitarian efforts, whether it be for agriculture, whether it be for medicine. We need to find ways to be able to do that.
I think the answer is definitely yes. And I think if you look at the cloud-enabled infrastructure, the processing can all take place where there's lots of power, right? And so you're essentially getting the result of the processing. So when you open up Google Translate and you set it down on a table and it translates between two languages and just repeats back what the other person said in the different language, the processing is not going on your phone, it's just a communications device, processing is going on in the cloud. And I think as more developing economies get more broad access to an internet infrastructure, that will enable, it's not the device itself that's expensive, it's the things that the device does. And so I absolutely see that happening.
Okay, very good. We are running out of time. So I have questions here from the audience that have been grouped by my colleagues here. So to Rob Shepherd, we have three questions with some overlap. Are the bionics only useful for movement neurological disorders? Can bionics be used in Alzheimer's, multiple sclerosis, or rheumatoid? And can it also be used for balance and movement disorder in terms of people who have vertigo and so on?
Sure. So the technology, the technology certainly has applications in balance disorders, and there's at least two groups around the world that are developing sophisticated bionics devices based on vestibular prosthesis. They've been implanted in one or two patients in early clinical trials. There's still a long way to go before they're commercially viable, but that work is certainly in progress. In terms of Alzheimer's and other central nervous system disorders, some neurosurgeons are tackling the use of deep brain stimulation for Alzheimer's. I don't think anybody's doing any work on MS. I'm not aware of that at the moment. rheumatoid arthritis and other auto-inflammatory diseases, such as Crohn's disease and other inflammatory bowel diseases, are a work that we and a number of groups are doing now by stimulating and modulating neural activity in the vagal nerve, which can reduce the inflammatory response for patients. So there are those applications that are in progress.
Thank you. And to Ray Johnson, how do you see the future of robotics outside of the medical area? I suspect they think about the military area as well. And a specific question about exoskeletons, which I think you already answered, in the cases, their usefulness in the case of spinal cord injuries.
Well, I'll answer that one first, I guess. This was a two-day conference, and the purpose of the conference was to talk about how wearables essentially can support the human activities. And they started off by taking an individual who had no ability to walk whatsoever, and he was able to control the device and walk literally down the aisle of, you know, like up and down, if there weren't stairs here. So it was a very impactful thing. So that's why I think there are certainly technical challenges, especially around the energy or power component, but I think it's great research to continue. And robotics in general, I think I used to have a phrase that we're going to move to unmanned everything. And I think, I didn't mention it, but the automobile, look at how fast from DARPA initiation, so this was about, 12 years ago or something like that, the initial DARPA grand challenge was to take unmanned vehicles and drive them in the desert and follow specific roads. And the first year, at the first switchback, the vehicles weren't able to go any further. And so they got, I make it up, I don't remember the distance, but 50 miles and they got 7 miles or something like that. And they couldn't go any further. The next year, they had one winner, somebody finished. I think several finished, but they had finished first. So they had, I think, three winners that year, three people who finished. So the learning that took place in unmanned vehicles 15 years ago, now we're seeing that every automobile company in the world now is doing research in unmanned cars, so driverless cars. And I think the way that this technology will develop, and I'll use the automobile industry as a good example of how I feel robotics will continue to develop, and not just in life sciences, but in general. So if you look at automobiles today, even relatively inexpensive automobiles have safety features that didn't exist in cars 20 years ago. Take, for example, anti-lock brakes. Anti-lock brakes came out of aircraft, which used anti-lock brakes to stop the planes as they landed. Then they moved into higher-end automobiles first, and then lower-end, and now almost every car has anti-lock brakes. I think the same will be true. The way we'll see unmanned features will be in safety assistance, and you're already seeing that in cars, where if you pull out to make a left turn in front of oncoming traffic, it senses that and it stops your vehicle. Or if you're not paying attention and you're about to run into the car in front of you, it senses that, auto brakes the car. I think we'll see a lot of those features. So autonomy and deep learning and all those features will begin to find their way into our daily lives in a lot of areas. And then ultimately, they'll take on kind of products and a life of their own. So I think, we'll see them sneaking up on us, but we won't notice it until they've made a pretty dramatic impact.
Okay, then thank you. Thank you, Ray. Dr. Khedr Abdurrahman, are robots going to take over human jobs?
Oh, well, that's a very good question. I will be back to two few things very quickly concerning the exoskeleton issue, because they have been raised a lot of time. So the problem is not just power, it's the impact, because if you have to consider a solution, you have to consider it in the whole functioning mode. What happens when you fall? How do you deal with that? The reason why I was speaking like this was that because I don't believe in exoskeleton. The way they are done today is not the proper way. And they have to be taught really to be a flexible core,
and not a rigid cover. Otherwise, it's not just the problem of power, it's also the problem of impact. And then I would go a little bit quickly to your remark, which is really the very heart of the question concerning this human-robot interaction. And the spirit of the research now is towards exactly what you were mentioning. Now we build robots to be taught by touch. I mean, the user do not need to program anymore. I mean, you get your robot like the KUKA arm in the industry, and then you teach the robot how to do the task just by manually, as you are teaching someone. The robot can learn from looking at you, and all these goes toward the human-robot interface to ease its use. Its use, and then it can be used, of course, in developing country. A most important brief remark to all the audience, especially the young generation: robotics is an affordable technology. It's not something you cannot do in a third or developing country. And then I will go back to your question concerning does the robot will take the jobs or not. So this is at the very heart of the Airbus project that we are going that we are doing now, clearly saying no, because it is simply impossible that the robot can take the job of the persons. And for instance, with the Airbus, the humanoid robots that we are manufacturing, we are designing in terms of research and after in terms of innovation, are really designed to be a sophisticated tool for a task that are very well identified and for which the in France, you know, the syndicate and the workforce is very powerful. I mean, even the workforce agrees that this task could be good given to the robots instead of the workers.
Thank you. And now, Ron, the question for you is, this is the audience question, and that's, what's the future of drones and 3D mapping drones? I suspect that that came from my colleagues who are in the GIS section, who spend a lot of time doing GIS maps. So they want to know whether they will be able to pass that on to drones.
Sure. I'll be glad to answer that. But I want to comment on the jobs. I don't have quite an optimistic point of view as my colleague here does. Jobs will be lost. There's no doubt about it, but jobs will be created as well. For example, Uber hired almost all of Carnegie Mellon's National Robotics Engineering Consortium. Yep. Why did they hire that? They don't want taxi drivers in the future. They think you will have a car come to your door and there won't be anybody in it. And it will, wouldn't it be nice in this traffic as well to maybe reduce the total numbers or something? But yes, there will. There will be significant impacts in terms of jobs. This is a debatable point. There are MIT professors as well, too, who predict doom. A colleague of mine at Georgia Tech predicts there will be more jobs created, but there will be changes in the workforce. That's the real thing that needs to be done. So one of the most important things you learn at the university is how to learn. And that's the key to success in your lives, in my estimation, to be able to, at any point in your life, retrain and to have a government that is capable of providing the resources for retrainment of displaced people and the like as well, too. But robotics will change the structure of society. Now, to drones, specifically with respect to 3D mapping and the like, there's all kinds of interesting work going on using algorithms which are called simultaneous localization and mapping. It's done undersea, if you consider drones, those that are below sea, those that are above ground as well, too. People are mapping cities, Google Earth, just driving cars through and rendering 3D models. And this is actually very useful, although a profound invasion of privacy, one could contend as well. But it's useful in the sense, if you're going to navigate, it's nice to know what the structures are that you will be navigating through. And also in the context of military operations, 3D mapping is useful if you're about to enter into a building that you've never in before, and you could send a micro flyer into that and build a map and representation that your warfighter might be able to understand before actually going into that particular building. But keep in mind again, when you're dealing with GIS type systems, geographical information systems, you're often dealing with orthographic projections and very high up representations, at least you were in the past. Down to the Earth is kind of dynamic. I would hate to assume that the traffic is going to be the same as it was at 6 a.m. when I step out here to try and cross the street, if I do that anytime soon. And the world changes. So this temporal dimension adds a whole new challenge as well, too. And so the advantage that drones afford is the ability to be have persistent stare. That means they don't have to go to the bathroom. They don't have to eat. They can be out for long, long, long periods of time and have long time range observations and gather information about patterns that may exist and changes in structure. So they can be extremely useful tools for understanding the world around us and providing information in many meaningful ways.
I would just like to briefly add that the robotics jobs from a robotics point of view are not, I think, the big issue. I think the big issue is the application of machine learning, deep learning, and robotics is the big issue. A lot of work done by, call it white collar workers today, involves thinking and the sitting at a desk and doing whatever it is that you're doing. And the deep learning capabilities, as they continue to improve and as compute power improves, et cetera, will be able to outperform people in most jobs. And they outperform in a number of jobs today. A good example that I like is a legal clerk. There's a process called discovery. And discovery means that you ask for a certain finite set of documents from your opponent, legal opponent, and you use those documents to your advantage. Deep learning algorithms routinely outperform humans because they can know every case law. They can know what's been successful. And if you have 25 documents that you want to pick, they routinely pick the right 25 documents that are most useful in that particular case. And so that can be expanded to a number of careers. And so I think the combination of artificial intelligence, deep learning, machine learning, whatever you want to call it, and hardware capabilities that can take on human-like behavior, then you really begin to see an interesting, dramatic change to what it means to be employed or a worker or earn a living in the world.
Well, thank you. Thank you, everybody. I really wanted very much to continue this conversation with this group around also the issue of artificial intelligence and the statements that have been made by Bill Gates and Elon Musk and Stephen Hawking and so on. But all good things must come to an end. And this session really has to conclude right now. And we are, however, going to make sure that everybody uses their break right now for lunch. So for the speakers, please go up one floor. For the participants, there's a big tent with food out there. And I hope we will all go and reconvene 2:30. I think it's only fair to give people 2:30. We reconvene here at 2:30. So please join me in thanking this marvelous panel.